and also with you.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for grace, for the gift of education. There are so many people in this world who love to get education, but they are not able. We thank you because you have enabled your daughter, our dear sister, with all the resources that enabled her to graduate from school. We thank you, Lord, for your name in Jesus Christ. We pray.
Amen.
Amen. How do you say happy, happy graduation?
Show all of us that your ways give more life than the ways of the world.
and that following you is better than chasing after selfish goals. Help our teachers, especially those who are filling in for Mrs. Cairo this morning. Give them strength, courage, and the wisdom to lead our children with the spirit of truth, to keep alive their joys in your creation. We ask all this through the Son, our Savior, our friend, Jesus Christ.
Amen.
When the saints
so.
If you love me, you will keep my commandments, and I will ask the Father, and he will send you the Spirit of truth. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
One as few.
As a few as
one as few.
As a few as
it's good to see you all. But it's especially good to see Canon Gio, who works with our provisional bishop, Bishop Daniels, with us this morning. Canon Gio will be meeting with the search committee after the service. You know, this being a Memorial Day weekend, the unofficial start of summer, many people are away, and I think this explains why we have so many empty pews today. Come on, Jill, the church is always while preparing this sermon, I could not stop thinking about my recent experience on the road in New Jersey. I was driving on Interstate 42, if you are familiar with New Jersey, and no sooner had I joined the Schuylkill Expressway, which is Interstate 76. Then I saw red and blue lights flashing behind my car. And in the mirror, I could tell it was a New Jersey state trooper directing me to pull over and stop. I knew I was in trouble. After the officer informed me that I had been driving way above the speed limit, then he handed me the ticket and I looked at the ticket. I just stared at the ticket. I asked the police officer why he had singled me out despite the fact that I was moving with traffic. His response was, you pay the ticket or go to court. The courtroom in Camden last Thursday was full of individuals holding speeding tickets. We were a diverse group. Teenagers because alcohol had been found in their cars. Immigrants whose native or second language is not English, accompanied by a friend who could either speak for them or translate what they were speaking. Several people, especially those who can afford legal fees, came with attorneys. You know, the American legal system allows those who cannot afford to pay for lawyers or cannot make their own case before a judge to apply for a state-sponsored defense attorney whose job is to make a case and advocate on behalf of the cause. Why am I telling this story this morning? People may be thinking, what? That's what you do? You drive recklessly? No, I don't. Exactly. And some people may be saying, next time we want to get the right from you. No way. How does any of this relate to today's gospel? We know that the lawyers and attorneys were common in those days, in the days of Jesus. They may have functioned differently from what we see today, but they professed and employed many of the same concepts. For instance, following his resurrection, Jesus tells the frightened 12, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And I will ask the Father, and he will give you another advocate. He will send another advocate to be with you forever. Again, I ask the Father, he will give you another advocate. I have to look up the definition of advocate. An advocate is a person who argues for or supports a cause or policy. A person who works for a cause or a group. A person who argues for the cause of another person. That's why I'm bringing up the campaign municipal court, which I attended on Thursday. It is possible when reading John's text to sense that Jesus is promising an advocate who will bring our case to the Father. Your case, my case, or the disciples' case before the Father. But that's not the case, because through the death of our Lord Jesus Christ on the cross, our cases were taken to the God the Father. We no longer need someone, because on the cross he said, "It is finished." However, John sees the function of the Holy Spirit as an advocate. He calls him the Spirit of Truth, whose work is to help the disciples grasp those things they did not understand when Jesus was still with them. The Holy Spirit will help them pop up in a world with which very soon will be rejecting them. That's the meaning of the word advocate in this context. In today's Gospels, we are presented with an understanding of the Holy Spirit not seen in other Gospel writers. John's perception of the Spirit is the Spirit of Truth that has something to do with Jesus' identity and his ministry of salvation. In John 6:14, verse 6, what does Jesus say?
If you're a very good Sunday school student.
What does John 14:6 say? If you can remember those memory verses that you learned in Sunday school. What does Jesus say? It's one of those famous saying, "I am," starts with "I am." I am this, I am this, and I am this. I am the way and the truth and the life. So if Jesus is saying, "I am the way," and if Jesus is saying, "I am the truth," and Jesus is saying, "I'm going to send the Spirit of Truth," what is Jesus saying? One more looking at that. What else? Jesus is saying, "I will send you the Spirit and the Spirit of Truth." And then in John 14:6, he says, "I am the truth. And I'm going to send you, I'll ask the Father, and he will send you the Spirit of Truth." What is Jesus saying? Jesus is indicating continuity. There is an understanding of continuity. What he's saying is that even though I'll be God, and I am the truth, and my Father sends the Spirit which is true, there is no break. There is a Spirit. There is continuity in the history of salvation, in the story of salvation. Therefore, if Jesus is the truth and he is promising to ask the Father to send the Spirit of truth, Jesus is saying to the disciples, "You don't have to worry. I am going to be with you. I am with you. I continue to be with you." The second way we can look at this text, that by being very specific about the Spirit of Truth, Jesus is making an affirmation to the disciples as well as all of us, that in this world, in this very world, there exists other spirits which are not from God. Of course, Jesus knew that the disciples were exposed and would have to deal with the spirit of fear and anxiety. What are the disciples dealing with? The spirit of fear and anxiety. And maybe that was the trigger for him telling the disciples not to let their hearts be troubled, but to believe in God and also believe in him. And one of the other spirits they would be encountering during the establishment of the new Christian communities, and especially when we look at the church in Corinth. What do we see in the church of Corinth? Just immediately after Jesus has left, we see a spirit of division between Paul and his companions. If you want to This you should read 1 Corinthians. You see the spirit of division, envy, you see the spirit of bitterness, the spirit of hurt and resentment, the spirit of self-gratification. And always, always waiting to attack his followers. We who believe must remember and also acknowledge and accept the fact that we are always surrounded by other spirits besides the spirit from God. The spirits are always ready and willing and able to attack and attempt to destroy the work of God. These spirits do not act as our advocates. These spirits are there to destroy us. Throughout history, for the past 22,000 plus, Christianity has been embroiled with the spirits of division. The Roman Catholic Church, Lutheranism, the Anglicans, Baptists, Pentecostals, each claiming to be the true carriers of the message of Jesus Christ. Canon Jill will agree with me that for the last 20 years, the provinces of the Anglican Communion have been at war with each other. The Church of Uganda, the Church of Nigeria, the province of the Church of Kenya, fighting the Episcopal Church of the United States, fighting the Episcopal, the Anglican Church in Canada. Always at war. Yet Trinity Episcopal Church. My dear friends, John has a message for all of us this morning. He charges us to be vigilant. He charges us to be on the alert for and aware of any spirit wanting to take us away from the work of God. Therefore, let each one of us be mindful and pray to be given the spirit of love, the spirit of love for the church, the spirit of love for one another, the spirit of love for our children, the spirit of love for those among us who need help. Let us pray and ask God to remove any spirit that may not be from Him. Let us ask God to give us the power to resist and despise any spirit that has the potential to turn us away from what we have been called to do, and as is, to love one another and to spread the good news of Jesus Christ. Let us pledge ourselves to asking God to give us that spirit of truth, to lead us in our conversations, in what we do, what we say. Let us always ask God to give us that spirit of truth in our worship team. And I have to tell myself, even in my preaching, I have said, for me, if I am preaching, if the text does not speak to me, I don't preach about that text. I find it very difficult to preach about that text. I mean, I could go online, I could go and read books and tell you what Calvert said. I could go and tell you what Martin Luther King said. I could quote for you what Martin Luther the Calvin said. I could quote the books and books of Cranmer. I will tell you what Cranmer had to say about this. I will not be speaking. I will not be listening. Jesus says, I will, if you love me, and if you follow my commandments. And which commandment is he emphasizing? A new commandment I give you. Love one another as I have loved you. Once again, Trinity, John has a message for all of us this morning. He challenges us to be vigilant, to be very careful, to be aware that in this world there are so many spirits that are wandering. Spirits of fornication, spirit of telling lies, spirit of doing this, spirit of doing that. All those spirits are only alive. As you move out of this church, just be aware of those spirits. They are watching you, they are following you, as you are driving on the next car. As we are driving in Delaware, those spirits are there, they are following us. Please, let us be mindful. Let us be prayerful. Let us be mindful of those spirits. How they to destroy the good work of our Lord Jesus Christ has done. The spirit of truth. Spirit of truth, we invite you in our midst this morning. Spirit of truth, we invite you to follow us. Spirit of truth, we invite you to guide us, be in our conversation. Spirit of truth, we invite you to guide us as we worship. Spirit of truth, we invite you to guide those who are teaching from Sunday school. Spirit of truth, we invite you to guide those who will be meeting after this service. Spirit of truth, we invite you to guide us as we prepare to give what you have given us, a portion of what you have given us. Spirit of truth, we invite you to guide us in all ways. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Thank you.
God we ask that you send the Spirit of Truth to guide us as we form different partnerships with different Episcopal churches. Christ our Trinity is one. God we ask that you will send the Spirit to comfort those who are sick and homebound. Our brother, Benson Ariko, our sister, Rosemary, our parent, Benjamin Ariko, our father, Solomon Ochi, Gloria, Boina Kamu. We pray for the soul of Sonia Kahinju,